I imagine that right now you're feeling a bit like Alice, tumbling down the rabbit hole. Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. What you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You felt it your entire life, that there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you mad. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. All I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. But I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people.
And now, welcome to another episode of Down the Rabbit Hole. Here's your host from federaljack.com. It's Popeye.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another live edition. It is November 8th, 2013, Friday edition of DTRH. And tonight, I am pleased to be bringing back to the airwaves a good friend of mine, a somewhat retired, well, I say somewhat because you never know when radio hosts have a tendency to just pop out of retirement, but it will say a somewhat retired for right now radio show host, activist, and all-around awesome lady, my good friend Gwen Caldwell. Gwen, welcome back.
Thank you, Popeye. It's a pleasure to be here.
I appreciate you taking 2 hours out of your busy schedule to sit down and chat with me. You know, I know that you are a very busy lady and you have a ton of things going on. So I really do appreciate you giving me your time tonight to sit down and talk about the important stuff that I want to go over. And for people that don't know, we're going to be getting into a bunch of stuff. First and foremost and most prominently, we're going to be discussing Native Americans and Native American issues, what's going on, what people don't know about, you know, history, some true history. Things that maybe you weren't taught in school. I think it's important to go over this stuff. I've had Gwen on to talk about this in the past, probably I think it was a little over a year ago last time we had a conversation about this. And this stuff is important. The true history, what's going on, the issues that the Native Americans face today, this is all important to me. Maybe it's because I have Native American blood running through my veins myself. Maybe it's just because growing up I've always had a respect and sort of reverence for the Native American culture. Whatever it may be, this stuff I feel is super important and needs to be discussed on the air. And I think people need to be exposed to it. So first and foremost, let's take a trip back in memory lane, Gwen, because I figure if we're going to talk about the issues that Native Americans go through today, the stuff that Russell Means fought for, things like that, and the people of his ilk, we have to go back in time to kind of give a little bit of a history lesson about what happened to the natives. Because most people don't realize, I think the general consensus of opinion that people have in this country, and that's because of the educational system, the indoctrination system, right, is that the pilgrims came here and they found the natives, which they refer to as Indians, and which I hate that term. They're not Indians, they're natives. Okay, if anything, you're going to call them either Natives or Native Americans. Don't call them Indians. It's kind of insulting. At least in my eyes it is, especially when you understand the true history. But anyway, they come here, and our history tells us that the pilgrims came here, the settlers came here, and that they found the Indians, and that the white people and Indians all got together and hunky-dory and loved each other, and the Indians taught the white people how to have Thanksgiving and all this other stuff, and That's actually not that's not true. I mean, Thanksgiving wasn't even put in until Abraham Lincoln was the president. He's the one that came up with that. Before, it was like a harvest festival, they used to call it. So history as we know it is quite different. And like I said, most people just think that, you know, the Indians and the white people got along, and then one day the Indians decided to be dicks and start attacking the settlers, and they scalped them and everything else. No one knows the true history of any of that stuff. So tonight I want to kind of lay it all to bear. So let's start with some of the older history. For instance, scalping. Scalping wasn't invented by the natives. That was actually something that was taught to them by the settlers, the British.
Exactly.
And the French. So, I mean, exactly. This is stuff that's not talked about. You know, I think in history books, the natives get a bad rap. You know, cowboys versus Indians. When I was a kid, it was always the cowboys were the good guys and the Indians were the bad guys. You know, that's what we were taught. And that's not actually so, is it?
No. The Indians found Columbus. he didn't find anything. I don't think people understand the history of Native slavery. That's an interesting bit of research. There's a very good book out. It's called Rediscovering Columbus, which tells the real history of Columbus and the absolute slaughter that ensued after his arrival. The pilgrims literally would have starved and died the first winter they were here had it not been for the goodwill and generosity of the original inhabitants of this continent. And like you say, you know, it's always been very interesting for me to look at photographs or pictures depicting Thanksgiving, where the pilgrims are dressed all warm and they're in these long dresses, the women are, and the men are in coats and everything, and the natives are in breechcloth. Really? You think? You know, it's the whole array of things that I've become very sensitive to in noticing. Right now there's a big issue with the Redskins. The Native tribes want that name removed, you know. For me personally, it doesn't bother me one way or another. I kind of learned a long time ago to tread lightly in two worlds. And so to me, I see it more of an honoring than a desecration of the people. But I see their point of view. And even in modern day stuff, we're seeing, as you know, Popeye, I'm a third generation product of Carlisle Boarding School. My grandmother went to the Carlisle Boarding School in Chicago. And what, in my work as a family rights advocate, what we see a lot is we saw Native families torn apart, children taken off to these boarding schools, had their hair cut, they were beaten, severely institutionalized. And so they did not grow up in a traditional extended family environment that would have been normal for them within the culture. And so they didn't learn things like what their role was in the family. They didn't learn parenting skills because they didn't see parenting skills role modeled. They didn't know how to prepare meals, preserve food, or any of those things because they weren't taught. I mean, it wasn't part of their daily activity. And if they did cook, it was in an institutional environment. So what happened when they came out of the boarding schools is They didn't know anything about conflict resolution. They didn't know how to interact with their biologic family, their nucleus, or their extended family. They didn't know how to raise children because it wasn't role modeled. And they had all this shame and guilt that they went out of those boarding schools with. And so they come out, they get married, they feel bad, they've got no dignity, no pride, they don't know where they fit in society and in culture anymore. And so you have a massive drug and alcohol problem across the reservations in North America. You have extreme poverty. You have people that have been indoctrinated into Catholicism and Christianity. And you have another generation of genocide subsequently, because now these parents are alcoholics. They don't know how to parent. They don't know how to clean their house. Not that they don't know how to clean their house. They don't know how to be in culture. And so as a result, the Department of Social Services, who has now replaced the boarding school era, and they are taking now the second, third, and fourth generation products of Carlisle Boarding School. And it's just an absolute cultural genocide. These Native children are being removed in the state of South Dakota. We have a 10%, roughly a 10% Native population in South Dakota. And 65 to 80% of the children removed are Native children, and almost all of them, once the parents' parental rights are terminated in violation of the Indian Child Welfare Act, those children are adopted out into non-Indian families. It's just a continuing agenda of the American corporation to eradicate the Native population. And what they don't do to the population is that, the Native way is circular. Everything is circular. And so time is circular, events are circular, just like the seasons, all of it. And what we see now is that this very linear colonial process of the Indian Reformation Act in the tribal governments, they aren't the extended family with the chief, the headsman, the firekeeper, the whipkeeper, the medicine man anymore. Now it's the little microcosm of the American corporation. And so it's very, it's still very brutal in that sense that there's some part of you, it in your DNA, you walk with a historical grief. It's right in your face all the time. You see the monuments all over everywhere you go to remind you that you've been a victim of one act of genocide and massacre after the other. And yet you're supposed to go around and act like you're this happy little camper. And then, it is a continuing agenda, and it's been very effective in destroying the culture in the one sense. And then in another sense, you see an emerging push for the children to learn the language, for them to reconnect with the earth, for them to... now people are doing research and bringing their extended families back together in those governmental, traditional governmental structures, within the communities and things like this. So, you know, it's, but yeah, it's been unbelievable. And it's not just the natives here, it's native populations across the globe.
But yeah, they have been under siege for hundreds, if not thousands of years. I mean, for at least the past few hundred years, and that's why Columbus actually came here and people actually started to do research. They didn't discover this world. They already knew it was here. They knew this land was here because the Templars had been here long before. They were coming over here. He was coming over here to claim it for the royal family who was in power at the time. And it's the same. These are the same bloodlines, whether they were ruling from Spain or whether they rule from the UK. It does not matter. You know, the old German bloodlines, it does not matter. It's these same families, this same group of 12 or 13 families that goes back thousands and thousands and thousands of years. And Michael Tessarion has actually written about this, how it's this systematic, like, you know, maybe unwritten rule, but thing amongst these families that they send their armies out to around the world to eradicate natives all over the world. That's why you see, even to this day, look what's going on in Canada, what goes on with you guys here in the United States, the Aboriginals over in Australia. And a lot of people, you know, have different personal issues about it, and they go, well, this is not fair, you know, these people, they want special rights. I don't think red herring or straw man arguments to drag you away from what's really going on. There's just been an agenda for hundreds of years to wipe out the native cultures of this planet, and there's a reason for it. Because they
can help. We talk about the reason?
Yeah. Well, I know one of the reasons is that I know one of the reasons, Gwen, is you guys help the natives help keep the ceremonies and the everything that the older natives, the older generations used to do, the dances and everything, that actually helped keep the earth in balance and the balance of power in the planet. A lot of people think this is all, you know, hullabaloo, but it's not. You can actually go look and say, I mean, the royals, the people that run things, right? They're the ones that actually set out their murderers to go kill the natives to stop this. So there's got to be something more to it than just, you know, myth, right?
Right. Well, they were really afraid of the native people. First of all, because they were so connected to the earth. But they had a strength and a spirituality about them that was unwavering. And part of the agenda at the boarding schools was to beat that out of them. And in fact, that was kind of the slogan, something to the effect, kill the Indian, save the child, kind of a thing. And and we see that now with what social services does. It's in the best interest of the child. Well, that was the same terminology that Hitler used in Germany and Austria when he was taking children and doing exactly the same thing. And what I find really interesting is that when they take your land and they take your children, I think those are two of the most I don't think that there's anything else that they can take besides your land and your children that has a more devastating effect on you. And I think part of that agenda was to quash the will to fight. And, you know, when Custer came in the 7th Cavalry, the Lakota were ghost dancing. They weren't armed. Wovoka had told them that he had had a vision that if they did this ghost dance, that the buffalo would return and the white man would go away. And so they started dancing, and they were told not to dance. And they continued dancing, and they danced for days until they were literally collapsing, and people were dancing around them. And that's how much they believed in the vision and how badly they wanted it to happen. And you've got a camp of over 300 elders, women and children primarily, that were unarmed, going into Pine Ridge Agency. And, you know, they call it, you know, the Indian Wars. That wasn't an Indian war. That was an Indian massacre at Wounded Knee on December 29th, 1890. You know, there was no battle about it. You don't have a battle when one side is armed and the other side is unarmed. That's a massacre. And over 300 elders, women, and children were murdered, you know, and left frozen in the snow. And then they dug a mass grave and dumped them all in there as if they were nothing. And then those soldiers were given medals of honor for doing that, you know. And in South America, too, the deforestation is taking the medicines, and it's you know, so that they can build dams and so that they can mine, and they always want to take the resources. And so what they do is they force the tribes to settle in small areas where they can no longer maintain their sources of food to feed their families, and then they become dependent on the government. And for all of you out there, I'm sure you know that a government that's big enough to give you everything that you need is big enough to take away everything that you've got. So it puts you in a situation where your very enemy is who you are dependent on for your survival, because you don't have the land base or the resources anymore left to feed yourself or to house yourself or clothe yourself. All of that was taken. And and I think at the core of it, the biggest fear was that they would, one, breed, two, that they stood in a spirituality that was so foreign, that was so connected, and so, you know, they weren't going to church and going to confession, and they weren't going through some priest to confess or save them or whatever. They just were. And it was clear that they were completely connected. And they feared that because they didn't have that kind of power.
Well, that's one of the reasons I know that they made the men cut their hair.
Yes, that's an interesting. That's interesting too. Yes.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't realize this, but Native American men, the reason why they grow their hair long is because to simplify it, it's basically they believe it acts like an antenna. It helps them get in contact with the spirit world, we'll say, and you know, all this energy and this connection that they have, by cutting their hair off. By the native men, they took great pride in their long hair, and that would be like if you have a beard. I have a beard. That would be like, and I've had my beard for a very long time. It would be like if you came up, if I was in a prison camp and they shaved my beard off. The same thing we did to a lot of the Iraqi generals and stuff when we invaded Iraq and we had them in prison camps. To them, it's demeaning. And it's the same thing they did to the native men. They cut their hair off and cut it very short. And they said, well, it's to make them fit in with society. But it's more than just that. Maybe the idiot cutting the hair thinks that. But there's people that are higher up the food chain that understand what they're doing at a much higher level.
I saw a video I wept. I wept of the children. It was slides of the Indian children. When they arrived at the boarding schools, they were standing in lines, and they were in the clothes that they came in, and so it shows them with their long hair and their clothes, and then it shows them going through the line and having their hair cut. And in every single picture, not only was the child that was getting their hair cut crying, all of the children in line behind them were crying. That's the most, that we cut our hair. When my husband died, I cut my hair. When my grandpa died, I cut my hair. Now, December 5th will be the four-year anniversary, so I'll grow my hair now, but for 4 years, you keep your hair short, and you're in mourning, and then you go back to that, growing your hair and all of that. But yeah, that was a huge thing. That was it really does take something from you. And there are some tribes that the women, when they're grieving, they would cut a finger off, but you don't, you didn't do that arbitrarily.
Well, that's more ceremonial, but cutting your own hair, yeah, is different than being, having your hair forcefully chopped off. Ladies and gentlemen, stay tuned. We got a break sneaking up. We will be right back. Don't go anywhere. We are back, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight I am talking with my good friend, Gwen Caldwell. She's a radio show host, and she's somewhat retired, we'll say right now, from radio show hosting. But she's still a very active activist. In the community, she's out there helping families. She's out there trying to raise awareness. And Gwen's a really good friend of mine. I've known her for a few years now, and I just absolutely adore her. She's awesome. One of my favorite people on this little blue marble that we all hang out on. And she really knows her stuff. And you have to. She's not just a regular old, She's not just some, activist that read some books about Native culture or the Lakota or anything. She is Native, so she's immersed in this her whole life. So she is what I would consider to be a foremost expert on the topic, on all the topics that we're talking about tonight. Anything but the topic of Native issues in general, because she's lived it. I can't think of anyone else that could be an expert on this. You could read books all your life and not have the understanding of things the way she does. So, Gwen, again, I'm glad that you gave us 2 hours of your time tonight. Let's get into assimilation. And we were starting to head there with the whole cutting of the hair of the males. And this is something I think we need to, a topic we need to spend some time on, however much time we have to. Assimilation. And you see the results of it today.
Yes.
The high alcoholism rate and everything else. I don't think people realize that's a symptom of a culture being destroyed and then assimilated into the Borg, we'll say. So, assimilation. I would say it started around when they were cutting the hair and everything. What did it do from there? Like, how did it pick up? I know, but for the listeners that don't know, what was the next step? First they cut the hair, then they put them in these boarding schools, and they just basic re-education camps, right?
They were. For me, I don't think the I think the idea of assimilation, I think had they left the tribes alone, they would have assimilated far sooner, and I think it would have been a less horrific transition with a lot less loss and all of that. But I was at a treaty meeting several years ago, and there were several different tribes. The Crow tribe was here from Montana, and of course the different councils from South Dakota, and there were a couple from North Dakota, and I believe there was also one from Montana and one from Minnesota. But there was a large group. There were representatives from Alaska, and you know, they always go back to the treaties, you know, and the discussion of assimilation came up, and I stepped outside, and there was a guy that came out, and he said something about the assimilation, and I just looked at him, and I said, excuse me, I said, why do you think it is, and how dare you assume that as a people we assimilate? Why don't you assimilate? And I said, oh, wait, that's coming. Because whatever befalls us, it befalls you. They just haven't gotten to you yet. You know, and that guy looked at me with the most shocked look on his face. He had never considered that. But in all of history, you know, wherever one person is oppressed or a people is oppressed, it doesn't stay there with that people. It spreads. And eventually, you become the menu item for the same oppression. And so this arrogance that the non-Indigenous people of this planet have about how you're supposed to assimilate, just get over it, move on, create a life, you know, until you know, I guess I'm not such an eloquent speaker that I can really describe that, but you know, it's really, I grew up in a non-Indian environment. We didn't speak the language. When I was a kid, we went to one powwow that I recall, but my father trained us in those ways. We didn't, I mean, we were taught that women are sacred, you respect your elders, you be in service to help your family, you know, you go and check on your grandma and your aunties and uncles and, you know, this kind of thing. So basically our family was that way, but we weren't that way with other families in a reservation setting or in an Indian community or anything like that. And so it was really, it was different for me because I went from the non-Indian world into the Indian world as an adult. And so I felt like I had come home, but I had the advantage of an education, of speaking other languages, of being able to travel, knowing how to get a job, having work experience, you know, how to drive a car and be able to get a job to afford a car and all of those kinds of things, you know. So when I went into that reservation environment, for the most part, I had a lot more going on for myself than most of the other women or whatever in my same age group. And I had to learn how to walk in both worlds. And when you see the suffering and you see the poverty on the reservations in South Dakota, there's an 80 to 90% unemployment rate. The life expectancy for men is 45. The life expectancy for women is 52. The rate of heart disease and diabetes is off the charts. The teen suicide rate is 300 times that of their stateside counterparts. Housing for, I would say, 80% of the people that live on the reservation live in substandard housing. There are many homes here that don't have any source of heat except for firewood, and they don't even have water. The rural water, they leave a tank there, and they come every week if they feel like it and fill your water tank. I lived in a place where I didn't have running water. I had a spring where I would get my drinking water, but there were three of us there, and we had a 65-gallon tank of water, and rural water would come once a week and fill my 65-gallon tank, and that's what we had to bathe in, wash dishes, flush the toilet, whatever, and that's how you manage yourself there, you know? So when you live like that and you hear someone say assimilate, it's a freaking joke. You know, it's like, do you really think we wouldn't like to assimilate? Do you think we wouldn't like to have just a little tad bit of what you have out there in that great big beautiful world of yours? There's no bridge. There's no bridge to get there. And that's the problem. I know four women. One woman has three college degrees. I know three other women that have Harvard degrees. And they come back with this, I'm going to help my people, yada, yada. Well, you can't help your people if you can't utilize your education to get a job to help your people. You know, there's no funding. There's no, you know, there's no economy base, nothing. It's unbelievable. And so when people talk about assimilation, you know, it's like talking about civilization, you know. John Trudell talks about that, what a lie it is. And if civilization isn't the lie, then the greatest lie is that it's good for us, you know. So for me, it's always been about having to bridge the gap. We have to, you know, there has to be a bridge. And when you've had all of your resources taken from you, and I mean, the Black Hills, they, you know, that is part of the Great Sioux Nation in the 1851 and 1868 treaties. It was stolen. There was a Supreme Court ruling that agreed that it was stolen. They're not going to give it back. We want to give you millions of dollars, which has been continually for years refused by the tribes, because the Black Hills are not for sale by the Great Sioux Nation. But they wanted the Black Hills because there was gold in the Black Hills. And they go up to the reservations, the three affiliated tribes in North Dakota, you know, they've just desecrated that reservation because they found oil, and the people there were so poor that they agreed to sign off their land to these oil companies so that they would get a lump sum check of $7,500, and they would get a pittance every month or every 6 months or whatever it was. And that's what they did. And their reservation is absolutely desecrated because of it. That reservation sits on top of the Bakken oil field. And so, assimilation is, you know, kind of a, you know, yeah, just grow up and be like us and put your big girl panties on and your big boy boxers and everything will be all right. It's not that simple. And
what did Russell used to say to us? Welcome to the reservation.
You want all of America. Yeah. Let's talk about that. Yeah.
Well, that's what's happening to us. You know, what they do to every subculture is what they're going to do to the country as a whole, because the country is a huge melting pot of all these different cultures, right? So they go, I don't want to say subculture, but they go out and they marginalize each culture, I should say. So they'll go after the Black community. They'll go after the Native American community. They'll go after the Latin community. They break it down, even the white community. They break down every community, however they can, into smaller groups because it's easier to manage, they being the powers that shouldn't be, the people that are doing the pushing this agenda behind the scenes, right? The people that run the machinations of all this. They push this stuff. So whatever you see going on to the natives, that's what we're going through actually right now. We're starting to feel the effects of it. You often hear even black people will say now when white people are, oh my God, I'm unjustly being, you know, profiled and harassed by the cops. And there's black people that are like, hey, you know, welcome to this. We've been going through this for years. You know, now you know what we've been going through. Now you have a better understanding that we've been going through. And they're right, because now everybody is actually starting to feel the effects. It's not just this little group that can be labeled a quote-unquote minority. It's
Popeye,
everybody is now the minority in the elite's eyes, right?
Yeah, I want to address something that someone wrote in the chat room. The Illuminati aren't forcing the natives to drink alcohol or have low aspirations. Anyone of any creed or color can start a business and sell something. They can then employ people. So I want to tell you, it was the Illuminati, actually, that brought alcohol to the natives. And it was done with intent. That's a historical fact. And you could probably even do a quick Google search and find information on that. It isn't that they have low aspirations. Quite the contrary. It's just that the environment, I see kids that that graduate, they go to college, and they do okay. Very low percentage, by far, with lot lower than their non-native counterparts. But sports seems to be a big thing. The kids like to do sports because then they can get a scholarship and it gets them off the reservation. But most of them join the military. Native Americans have the highest per capita enlistment rate of any nationality in the armed services of the United States. And yeah, they can start a business and sell something, but I don't know anybody anywhere that can start a business with no startup money. And part of the problem is that they don't have cars that run, and or they can't afford the car insurance to drive stateside. So the minute you leave the reservation to go where there's any money to sell anything that you have, you get pulled over and harassed by the police. And so it becomes very undesirable. And they also
people aren't taking into account that the natives grew up in a situation, at least right now, where their whole culture has been destroyed, and they're in this almost like limbo. You guys are in this limbo right now where you have the older generations that want to, you know, teach the younger generations the ways of the old and get back into the traditional way of things and the ceremonies and all that. And you have this schism, I guess, where they've grown up in this reality of, yes, there are people that want to go back to the old ways and they've heard of the old ways and how different it was, but their reality is not that. And for somebody that's never grown up in that situation to be judgmental and say, well, why don't they just do this? You're not in their situation. You don't have a full comprehension of it. It's just like if you say to somebody, well, I don't understand why people live in the ghetto. They should just move out. Well, you don't understand the full scope of things, their reality. You're not there. You're not living in that reality. So
well,
you,
Papa,
you can't
and
have
I
a full understanding.
About,
you know what I mean?
I think you and I talked about this on another show that we did about Obamacare, and I said, please, I invited people that thought Obamacare was great, please come and stay at my place. I'll pick you up at the airport and I will take you out and I will give you a tour of not only Obamacare, but the world that Obama wants to create for you, because it's a mini microcosm of socialism that is so frightening, I can't even begin to tell you. And everyone thinks that that's crazy. You know, oh, well, you know, Canada has free health care and it's just great for them and all of that. So, you know, we've got an environment that is now expanding into the stateside, because I think they used the reservations basically to, you know, it was like their test run, and it was their colonialism and their divide and conquer and their separation and their all of that was so effective that they have absolute and complete control over what goes in and out of the reservations, how those, you know, the medical care is provided by the Department of Navy, the food's provided by the Department of Agriculture, you know. So yeah, people go, well, that's my treaty right. Yo, you know, I think I'd be doing something besides depending on my treaty rights if those treaty rights were the continuation of a genocide agenda. Come on, you know. But when you don't have any food, when you don't have any food, are you going to take the crappy commodity food that you're being given, or are you going to go hungry? No, you're going to take the commodity food. So now we've got 47 million people in the United States on food stamps. That's more than 10% of our population in this country. You think that, now the non-Indians, oh, they're losing their jobs, they're losing their homes, their land, their kids. Assimilate. Yeah, assimilate. What the hell does that mean anyway? Because I don't hear any Indians going out and telling the white people that are whining around about not having a home or a job anymore, or losing their kids, oh, assimilate. Oh, well, Russell did. Gotta love Russell. So yeah, it's something that is the reservations are a microcosm of the macrocosm, and you know, we're seeing it grow in this country now in rates that are unbelievable.
The law of correspondence, Gwen, as above, so below. You're correct. That's why, like Russell used to say, welcome to the reservation.
Right.
I don't think the middle class folk realize it yet. That's all. They just don't realize it yet. But the whole country's become a reservation. We just don't realize it yet. There's little pockets of elitists, and that's it. And that's where they're pushing us. I mean, we have a chance to turn it around. It's not like the end is nigh and that's it. Give up. But that's where we're headed.
Can I give you a perfect example of I don't know. I mean, I kind of feel bad talking about this, but I'm going to anyway. So, Alex, if you're listening, please forgive me, but I'm going to talk about your family. The White Plume family on the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation, they went to their tribal council so that they could get a resolution passed in order to grow hemp. Hemp grows wild in the ditches on the reservation. You don't see any feds coming in and harvesting that, but their Teochbai, their extended family, they made a land use organization according to the mandates of the tribal resolution, and they were allowed to grow hemp. And so they grew the hemp, and the day before the harvest, the feds came in and chopped down their crop. Their entire crop. And I mean, they had helicopters and big U-Haul trucks, and oh my God, it was just unbelievable. If you want to see what people on the reservation, when they try to be self-determined, and they try and do something to help their families. Watch the film, I believe it's on YouTube, called The Standing Silent Nation. And it will give you a very clear overview of what happens when an Indian dares stand up and want to do something for themselves and their people. Because the feds will come in and they will take you out. They are not going to have a self-determined population. They are not going to have a population that can be self-sustaining. They will not permit it. Bottom line.
Well, look at what's the name of that movie about Leonard Peltier? What is it? Incident at Oglala. Oglala. Go watch that movie. It's on Netflix. It's a really good documentary. In fact, I'll just do it because I play documentaries for the listeners sometimes. I'll just set it up one night and I'll play the. I got to see if I can fit it in the time allotted, but if I can, I'll just play the full audio of the documentary for everybody so they can get at least a somewhat idea of what happened. But they should really go watch the documentary. It's a perfect example of the federal thuggery and what happens. It's almost like the king's men. They can come in, do what they want, and if you defend yourself in any way, shape, or form, you're an evil, bad guy, terrorist, or whatever ist they want to put on you, communist, terrorist, whatever, nativist, maybe, right? Oh my God, they're nativists, right? Who knows what, whatever, they'll probably just call you, they probably just labeled you guys Native American terrorists, and that's it. Now you're the bad guys. I don't think people realize that's happening to all of us. It's not just this one little subsection of the society, okay, where people can go, well, it's not me, you know. But what's that old poem from during World War II when they were rounding everybody up? When they came for the communists, I didn't say anything because I wasn't a communist. When they came for the trade unionists, I didn't say anything because I wasn't a trade unionist. When they came for the Jews, I didn't say anything because I wasn't a Jew. When they came for the homosexuals, I didn't say anything because I wasn't a homosexual. Well,
exactly.
What do you think's going on when they came when they messed with the Indians, or excuse me, when they messed with the natives, right? Because they say Indians when they messed with the Native Americans. Same thing. When they mess with the black people, same thing. When they mess with the Latin culture, same thing. It's the same mentality. They're going after each individual section. And now they've got them where they feel that they're under their control. Might have taken 20, 25 years, whatever, but they push them down. And now it's everyone else. And it's, hey, you weren't there. You weren't there when they were getting subjugated. And now you're going to get it because you didn't stand up. And we still have a chance to stop this. We all need to. We still have that slim window of opportunity. I always say that it's not hopeless. There is still hope. But we have to face this stuff and we have to learn true history and understand what really happened. Gwen, I'm going to cut us off because the break is sneaking up on us. Ladies and gentlemen, do not go anywhere. We have another hour with Gwen. We're going to get into Russell Means and more. So stay tuned. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with hour number two here on tonight's live edition of Down the Rabbit Hole. I am your host, Popeye, from FederalJack.com. It is November 8th, 2013, and tonight I am joined by my good friend, activist, and somewhat retired radio show host, Gwen Caldwell. Gwen, welcome back for hour number two.
Thanks, Popeye.
Thank you so much for giving me and the listening audience 2 hours of your time tonight to go over this stuff. But as I said, you have lived this. You've walked. You walk in both worlds, as you say. You live in both worlds. And you have a unique perspective of not only understanding Native culture but also and their plights, but also understanding the general culture, we'll say, and the level of ignorance to the true history and everything that's going on around them. Plus, you're also awake as to this whole agenda. So you have this unique perspective on things. And without your input, I think it would probably be a lot more difficult to get the level of understanding across to the individual about what's going on. So I really do appreciate you coming on and taking the time to sit and chat with me, dear.
Well,
so
thanks.
Let's get into Russell Means a little bit. I want to talk about Russell because we've mentioned him a couple times tonight. And there are probably a lot of listeners that know who Russell is, but I'm sure most people, I would say at least 50% of the listening audience probably doesn't know who he is. The name might get lost on them. So you knew Russell. I mean, I could talk about him, but you knew him, like personally you knew him. So it would be better for me to let you introduce the audience to Russell Means. So just, you know, give a little bit of background as much as you want on Russell. You know, people can go look him up. But, you know, give a little bit of background of who he is and, you know, the kind of activism that he did. I mean, yes, he was also in some Hollywood movies in his later life as an actor, because he did have another career as an actor later on, but when he got older. But when he was younger, he was a prominent activist. And a little more than that, I guess you could say. And he became famous for a reason, we shall say. So I'll let Gwen have the floor, because as I said, she knew Russell better than anybody I know. She actually knew him personally. And she could do him the justice and the honor that the gentleman is due, at least in my opinion. So Gwen, the floor is yours, my dear.
Thanks. Yeah, Russell was a father, a husband. He was an actor. He was an activist, but he was an original founding member with the Belcourts and Vernon and Clyde Belcourt and Cooney Dog and John Trudell, and you know, there were a lot of them. Leonard Crow Dog. The Poor Bears, they were all part of that initial. The Rubidoux, I think, were also involved in that. But he was at Wounded Knee during the siege at Wounded Knee in the 70s, 1973, I think it was. They occupied a church there, and they used that. They went there with the blessing of the elders to fight against the oppression of the tribal government. There was a half-breed president, Dickie Wilson, and he had his goons out just whipping up on the full-bloods out in the districts, and there was a lot of internal fighting on the reservation. There was a very high FBI, federal, you know, presence. To date, I believe there are 285 Native people that have gone missing that have never been found, or no one has ever been charged with the murder of those people. So there was a lot of really horrific stuff. John Trudell.
Those were the death squads that were roaming around the reservations at night, right?
And just randomly. They called them goon squads. They called them goon squads. Guardians of the Oglala Nation is what they called them. But they were all half breeds, and they had guns, and they'd block the roads. People would be traveling at night, and they just come out of the ditches and stop them, and you know, just, you know, it was pretty horrific. So they met at the church in Calico with the elders, and they were given the okay, and then they all went. They went to Wounded Knee. And it was interesting. They were there during the winter, so it was quite cold. Food was scarce. A child was born there. Men died there. Others were shot. Russell has always been a voice for the people. And he has a very commanding presence, and he's a very, very eloquent speaker. And I don't know, you know, it's just kind of funny. My son and I, we were out on the stronghold which is in the south unit of the Badlands. And during Dickie Wilson's days, he signed a memorandum of agreement with the federal government to include that as part of the Badlands National Park, and they were supposed to do all kinds of things that never got done. And well, then it was discovered that there were people going in, taking out artifacts and desecrating teepee rings and removing dinosaur bones and whatever, you know. We went out there and started, you know, occupying it and protecting that south unit. And so Russell didn't stay out there. You know, it was kind of scary, you know. I was the only woman out there. My son was the only child. But you're out in the middle of flipping nowhere. And you're right on the edge of the Badlands. And that's right where, when they had the massacre at Wounded Knee and people started running, they ran up Wounded Knee Creek and they left on horseback. Well, some of those people they were riding so hard that they rode off the edge of the Badlands and there were shelves below. And so when we started going around, we found remains of horses and riders, you know, on those shelves that had never been discovered or had never been removed. And on one perimeter check, one of the guys out there, he's crossed over now, George Tall, he said, come over here, I want to show you something. And he showed me this huge ant mound. It was just huge. I'd never seen anything like it. But there were little beads all over it. And I went, oh my God. And it reminded me of a story I'd been told a long time ago about this old woman who used to sit on the edge of the world. And she had her dog there with her. And every time she would get up to stoke her fire, that dog would tear apart her beadwork. And so the story went that if she ever finished her beadwork, that the world would end or something to that effect. So when I saw that, I started looking around for a fireplace. And I have a friend who's she's a tribal archaeologist, and so I've gone with her, and she's shown me things to look for and how to identify certain things. And fireplaces were one of the things that she showed me how to identify. And sure enough, there was a fireplace there. And I went, oh my God. And so I thought, I wonder if that old woman sat here and beat it. And that's where that story came from. But anyway, that's kind of off the topic. But anyway, that I just thought it was kind of a cool story. But anyway, so one day I'm out doing a perimeter. You know, they've got the Forest Service flying in these planes, real low over us, the feds flying real low over us, you know, like trying to intimidate us and, you know, things like that. And so there was a fairly good sized camp set up there. And so my daughter had been at her dad's for the summer, so she wasn't there, but it was just my son and I, so it was our turn to do the perimeter security check. So I'm driving around, and there were rocks, and I'd been looking for rocks that I could use with my solar shower. So I was trying to make a rock floor for the shower so I could have some place to shower out there. And so I'm looking for rocks as I'm going around. So I bent down to pick up a rock, and I never even heard this helicopter. But I turned, and this helicopter is right there. It had just like popped up from down below. And I was just like, eye level with this helicopter, no markings on it, black. And it did not make a sound. I'm not kidding you. It was so, and you know, at that point, you don't know whether to, you know, run and hide in your car or whatever. And I thought, you know what, if I'm going today, hey, it's a good day to go, and I'm standing here, and so I just yelled out some I just yelled out some things in Lakota, and I just stood. I mean, I just stood as straight up like a mama bear as I could, and my son's looking at me with just this. You know, he's completely lost all color in his face, and his eyes are huge. And so, anyway, I just stood up and stood there, and the pilot started laughing and then went up and left. And I went, oh, my God. I mean, things got real for me, real, I mean, just right then and there, you know. So anyway, it was a couple of weeks later that there was a big meeting that had been planned with the local, regional, and federal Forest Service and Park Service and all of that to come and meet with us about how we were going to protect this area and to dissolve the memorandum of agreement. And so I, by this time, my daughter was back from her dad's, and so she was there, and so she brought a notepad. She was always taking notes, and she thought that would be a really good homeschool thing to take notes on. And, you know, the women are cooking, and the kids are playing, and the men are smoking and walking around and visiting. And so the big cheese from D.C. or Omaha or wherever he was from, he was kind of moving to the front like he was going to finally say something that we should all hear. And so anyway, then Russell Means comes walking up, and he always had, you know, he always had his hair wrapped in these leather ties, you know. And, you know, he walks with purpose, you know. And my daughter's like, Mom, who is that guy? And I said, that, my dear, is Russell Means. And she's like, why does he walk like a peacock? And I think she was about 8 at that time. Why does he walk like a peacock? I said, well, because he can. So, you know, he was, you know, he was, I wouldn't call it arrogant, but he was very sure of himself, and he never backed down, and he was very vocal. And at that meeting, after that guy spoke, he stood up and very eloquently reminded him that that was treaty land. It was part of the Great Sioux Nation under the 1851 and 1806 treaties. The Memorandum of Agreement was a moot point. It was not done by an act of Congress, and that he should go back and revisit the Constitution to find out that treaties are the law of the land. And so he wasn't afraid to stand up to them on any level, you know, and really remind them and put them in their place. And, you know, Russell and I, you know, not only in that situation, but the child welfare issue was another time I called him and I said, you know, Russell, they're taking these kids. The state's supposed to meet 20 of 17, you know, 20 of, you know, things in order to be reimbursed for foster care of these Indian children. They're only in compliance with 3 of them. You know, and this is just more genocide. And I want to start having meetings, and I want to start talking about this on the reservation and get everyone brought up to speed about what's going on. And he said, I think you should do it. He said, Gwen, I think the women are going to have to stand up, and this is going to have to be their battle. They're going to have to stand in their rightful sacredness. But I want you to know that us men, we're going to stand behind you. And in addition to that, if you want radio airtime, I will give up my Wednesday show on Keeley Radio, and you can have that hour to come and talk about this every week. And I'll happily give you that time. So when I went to the first meeting, I'd invited the press. I had put press releases out in all the Indian country newspapers, sent it out to all the news, local newspapers, the TV stations, radio stations, and so forth. And as is customary, you know, we brought food to feed the people and serve coffee and so forth. And I got up to speak, and I looked, and you know, there are three grandmas and the women, and one, the only man sitting down was a reporter from one of the Indian country newspapers. And I looked up, and around the whole of the room, all the way around on three sides of the room, it was wall to wall with Indian men standing there. And I had this aha moment that I can't even begin to describe to you, because I had a full understanding at that point when he said the men will stand behind you. That was not that wasn't a figure of speech. That was a literal, we're going to stand behind you. And so that was the kind of guy Russell was. He was impeccable to his word in that sense. We had relatives that were murdered at White Clay, found dead in the ditch, you know. The only eyewitness was discounted as being a delusional drunk, so her testimony wasn't regarded as a fact. And no one has been arrested to this day for those two lives that were left laying in the ditch. But she saw police officers, state police, Nebraska state troopers, beating them. And so we had a march. And I was big and pregnant then with my youngest child. It was hot. It was 110 degrees that day. And we marched, about 2,000 of us, from Pine Ridge to White Clay. Again, helicopters all over the place. We were greeted at White Clay by full riot gear, Nebraska police, state police. And Russell, you know, Russell was there. He was on the front lines of that, you know, and just saying, no, we are not going to allow you to kill our relatives. We're not going to allow this to go unnoticed. And, you know, here I am, big and pregnant. People are going, what in the hell are you doing out here walking in this heat when you're that pregnant? And I said, I have Indian children. And if the numbers count, I want them to be counted now, because I don't want to find any mother's dead children laying in a ditch, beat to death, ever again. So if I can stand up now and be counted, count me. And I went on that walk, a memorial walk, on that walk every year for, I think, 7 years. I went on that walk from Pine Ridge to Camp Justice. And so, and Russell was involved in that as well. He was very active in trying to close down White Clay. He was at many meetings that I went to in Nebraska to try and compel the Nebraska legislature to enforce the law there. And it's, you know, White Clay, it's a town of 9 people. The population is 9. It's 2 miles from the reservation, Pine Ridge, and they sell $4 million worth of beer primarily to people on a dry reservation, and they're in a 5-mile buffer zone of the reservation and are supposed to comply with tribal law based on that, and don't. And so there's been quite a bit of controversy about that. And so Russell was very active in that as well. he also was very concerned about the children not learning their languages, not knowing their ways. So he opened his ranch in Porcupine up. He called it the Treaty School. And to teach the kids about the treaties, to teach the language, to teach them how to garden, how to build alternative homes. And they could ride horseback there and learn how to care for the livestock and those kinds of things. And he spent his last years there. I also worked on a political campaign with him when John Thune ran against Tom Daschle for U.S. Senate, and had an opportunity at that time to meet his wife, Pearl, who was just a lovely, beautiful woman. They were very complimentary of one another, and just really, really very nice to have them as part of that adventure as well. So that's, you know, I guess basically when he found out that he had throat cancer, he started to travel. He traveled to a lot of different indigenous cultures to try and cure himself naturally. So for that period of time, I didn't have any interaction with him. So I wasn't part of that. So I'm not really sure how and where all he went. I did read updates from Pearl occasionally, but he was a warrior,
a lot of the stuff that you talked about with the goon squads and all you had family members that wound up dead. Nobody, they went missing, and then they found them dead, and nobody knows who killed them. And all the other issues that you just brought up, there are, we mentioned earlier, there's a bunch of documentaries that people can go and watch online. And I will play, as I promised, coming up in the future, sometime in the next few weeks, I'll play the audio, if I can fit it into the 2 hours with the break schedule and everything, the audio from the documentary Incident at, and I want to pronounce this right, Oglala, right?
Oglala, yeah.
Okay, yeah, you have to go watch that movie, because that documentary in and of itself shows there's more to learn than just that. Don't watch that documentary and think you know it all. But it's, if you're going to start somewhere to understand some of the issues that Gwen's talking about with these goon squads and all the other stuff, the things that Russell fought for, and all the other men that stood with him at the Siege of Wounded Knee in the 70s, for you to understand what led to that and why Leonard Peltier's still in prison to this day, which, I mean, they should just let him out. It's ridiculous. But you have to have an understanding of why I would say that, or why Gwen would bring that up to explain a little bit of history to you, to have a better understanding of it. Go watch these documentaries. And Gwen, the break is sneaking up on us. When we come back, I'll have you give out whatever the list of documentaries that you know about. I know you said a couple of them, so I'll have you give out the names of them again when we come back on the other side, sure, of the break, so everybody can check into that. And if you know of any books or anything people should read, you can throw that stuff out there too.
Sure.
And because people need to learn this stuff. Again, you're going to be, like Russell said, welcome to the reservation. We're going through the same things right now ourselves. Everybody, the whole country. They're turning the whole country into a reservation. So pay attention. We'll be right back. Don't go anywhere. We are back, ladies and gentlemen. Final segment of tonight's live edition of Down the Rabbit Hole. Hanging out with my good friend Gwen Caldwell. Again, she's giving us 2 hours of her time. She's a very busy lady. And she's giving us 2 hours of her night to sit down and go over these issues. And this, in no way, by the way, I have not done Native Americans any justice with this broadcast. I mean, we have. This has been an epic broadcast, but this isn't enough information. There is a ton more videos, documentaries, just there's a ton of information out there that you need to go research and understand of what happened, what's real, what's happened in the past, what's going on currently. You need to know this. I mean, it affects you, even if you don't realize it affects you. So go pay attention to it. And Gwen, when we were going into break, I had said that you know of a bunch of different documentaries. I mentioned the story about Leonard Peltier. But what happened there's a documentary you were telling me about with where you were talking about last segment, the whole cutting off of the alcohol. There's actually a couple different documentaries out there that are important. But what happened with all of this information is it's suppressed. It's put out on Netflix, but you don't see it put out in the mainstream movie theaters or anything like that. So people really don't know about it. So where can people go find this stuff if you know anything else other than Netflix? If it's only Netflix, that's cool. Any websites you want to throw out there? Any books? And what documentaries would you specifically recommend?
The Battle for White Clay is a very current, fairly current and an ongoing issue. The Battle for White Clay. You'll probably have to Google search for these because I think they are privately produced and you have to buy them from a website or Amazon or something. But The Battle for White Clay is one. The other one is Tattoo on My Heart, The Warriors of Wounded Knee, which also includes interviews from Russell Means, Bill Means, Webster Poorbear, Madonna, I just went brain dead. Can't remember her last name. But anyway, it's interviews with people that at the time of the filming were still living. Most of them have made their journeys now. And you know, I want to talk about that when we come back. The other one is Alex White Plume, about the White Plume family, and it's called The Standing Silent Nation. And a really great book that, you know, people always ask me that, you know, what's a good book to read? And, you know, so I can learn more about the culture. I think one of my favorite books is Black Elk Speaks. Ed McGaw writes some books. I mean, they're okay for an introduction, but they're really not culturally correct. I see a lot of books that are written, but they're not really told how it is, because they're not going to tell the whole story. Another book is let me think, what is the name of that book now? It'll come to me. But I would start with Black Elk Speaks, because that's a true, his real visions and how it really is and was and all of that. Another book that was really historically correct and it was really well researched is called The Dull Knives of Pine Ridge. And that's about my friend Guy Dullknife's family. And it is historically accurate as well. And I think that goes back four or five, maybe six generations. So Terry, it's not Battle for White Cloud, it's Battle for White Clay, Clay. There are a lot of other good books out there, there are a lot of people that write books, like Mary Summerrain, and people think, you know, that a lot of those are, there's another woman, I think her name is Lynn Anderson, Mary Summerrain's books are accurate, but she spent time with a medicine woman, No Eyes, she was an Ojibwe grandma, who was blind, and she spent time with her before her death. And but a lot of the books are written as if they're factual, but they're written by people who aren't really Native and didn't really have those experiences. And so you really have to be discerning about the information. Another really great book by Charles Eastman is called Mitakiyoasan, and I'll write that in the chat room.
Which, by the way, if anybody wants to go to the chat room, you can go over to either truthfrequencyradio.com, and up in the header bar there, there's a link to go to the Truth Frequency chat. Or if you go over to federaljack.com and go to the Down the Rabbit Hole Listen Live page, there's a window which is, acts as a portal to the chat room at the bottom, right underneath the player, because I just use the Truth Frequency chat that all the other hosts use. It's much easier that way. So you can get into the chat room a few different ways, and you can go see whatever information Gwen or any of the other guests I have on or myself ever. You can always go over to those two links and two spots. Gwen, I got to ask you this, because there's two things I want to get into with you, and we're running out of time. One thing I forgot to ask you earlier, and I want to go back to this really quick. How powerful was it for you when you were walking on the very ground where Wounded Knee happened, and you were, you know, walking up that the embankment, and then you realized that you guys had found riders that had ridden off the edge, that were literally driven because they were riding so hard, and you found these remains? How powerful was that for you as a Native American woman yourself? Obviously, I mean, like you said, you walk in both worlds, but you are spiritually, you know, grounded to your native roots. You understand everything, and you have, you know, you feel it yourself. You have that emotional, understanding of it as well. How powerful was that when you were walking on that ground there?
Well, I would like to back up, because when I made my first trip to South Dakota, I don't know, maybe some of your listeners know, maybe they don't, but I worked in artist management, and I was doing a 3-day event in Bemidji, Minnesota. It was an intertribal, multi-generational event, so I had come to South Dakota. It was in February, to meet with John Trudell, who was going to be participating in that event. And there was, it was the anniversary, the 35th anniversary, or something, I don't know. It was some big anniversary of the Wounded Knee occupation. And so I was coming over here, and it became very clear to me from 15 minutes from the time I left my house that I had no control over this trip. I mean, we literally mapped out, you know, highlighted the route we were going to take, not, you know, there was, we just drove in this complete and utter whiteout. We were stopped in Martin, South Dakota. We couldn't go any further because there were 6-foot snow drifts blocking the road with semi trucks hijacked and in the snow banks. And so there were hundreds of us stranded in this little tiny South Dakota community that is another reservation border town. So anyway, the following day, we had to go south into Nebraska, cut across northern Nebraska, and then back up into the reservation to get to Wounded Knee, where the mass grave is. And I am telling you, I could not walk up that. There's a hill that takes you up to the graveyard, and I literally had men on either side of me helping me to walk, because I was shaking so bad that I couldn't stand. And when I got to the top of the hill, there was a grave there, and you know, Buddy Lamont, who died at the siege, you know, he's got a really big, newer, beautiful headstone and all that, but most of the graves are just small little crosses or some little headstone, not anything like you would see in a normal graveyard. And then there's the mass grave that is surrounded by a chain link fence with kind of this Masonic looking something there with the names on it. But this grave, it was just this pitiful little grave, and it had just this pitiful little cross, and it was a wooden cross. And when I got to that grave, I just, something, just like something physically turned my head, and I looked at that grave, and it was like somebody hit me in the back of my knees, and I literally dropped on the ground, and I sat in front of that grave crying. And all it said on that cross was Lost Bird. And I'm like, who the hell is Lost Bird? You want to hear a story of colonialism and genocide, look up the story of Lost Bird. That's quite a story. So anyway, yeah, so that was my experience at the gravesite the first time I went there. The remains, I can tell you that I was out there with some of, Vietnam veterans, warriors, and everyone that was there was literally sobbing. It wasn't only a sadness, but it was that they just got left there like they were nothing, and that nobody went looking for them, or they didn't have a family left that even knew they were missing because everyone had been massacred. And so it was, it was a blow. It was shocking, to say the very least. And it would take more than this show to describe the things that happened on the stronghold. Literally, it was powerful, the stuff that I saw and witnessed there.
I can only imagine the energy that's trapped there. Horrific events and massacres and things like that have a way of keeping energy. Sometimes even, some people say it's their souls. I think it's more of the energy released was so powerful that it was it's more of like a recording, etched into the surroundings. Especially, I find if there's a lot of quartz stone in the ground, it has a people that can look up, people that investigate paranormal stuff, will see that a quartz stone actually acts like an energy, almost like a battery. And I just from my research over the years, I look at Gettysburg, same thing, so much death and destruction there, the energy released, I can only imagine. But then in the natives' case, it's so much more because of their spiritual beliefs and their connection to both worlds. And their reverence for both. I can't even imagine how powerful of a feeling it must have gone from the tips of your toes to the top of your head. Just amazing, and in so many ways. And it must have been amazing to find the remains of the riders and the horses and stuff. I mean, what was done was horrific. Most people have no clue about it, and that's why I wanted to bring you back on and even talk about this stuff, Gwen, because most people have no idea. The history books on that are, well, there's those savages, the Indian savages. If it weren't for those Indian savages, the first white folk over here would have starved to death and froze to death. So, and how did we repay them, by the way? We gave them blankets with smallpox. Here you go. Merry Christmas.
Yeah, genocide. Yeah, if people, if you think you can trust your government, ask a native how well that works out for you. Popeye, there are a couple other things that I do want to bring up that I think are
go ahead. We got about 11 and a half minutes, so the floor is yours. Go ahead.
I want to talk about the uranium mining, the Keystone XL pipeline, the fracking that's going on, the oil drilling. All of these things are desecrating the land and the water. In South Dakota, in Edgemont, South Dakota, which is in far southwestern South Dakota, for years they have mined uranium there. And It has contaminated the water in five states. From the gold mining in the Black Hills, hundreds of miles away, the water is full of arsenic because of it, very high levels of arsenic. And now the fracking, they're putting chemicals into the ground and cramming it in the ground to force the gas up so that they can harvest the natural gas, and it's contaminating the groundwater and the aquifers in virtually every state where they're doing fracking. There are a few states now that have stopped fracking. It also causes earthquakes, but it's an issue. The Keystone XL pipeline they're moving tar sands from Alberta, Canada, and the entire route is in treaty land. The chemicals that they use to move the tar, if you have a crude oil spill, there are natural microbes and things that will eat it, and it's natural, it's organic, and it makes a mess, but it doesn't do the kind of harm that chemicals do. And that Keystone pipeline goes from Alberta down to hook up with the goes through Nebraska, Montana, South Dakota, part of North Dakota, South Dakota, and Nebraska to hook up with the southern portion of that pipeline. And it crosses many aquifers that are they're shale bottomed aquifers. So the water that is in those aquifers comes from rainwater that seeps but can't seep any lower because of the shale. And it crosses at least two of those in South Dakota. It crosses the Yellowstone River the Missouri River twice, and it crosses the Oglala Aquifer, which is the drinking water source of over 8 million people, or 2 million people in eight different states, something like that. But that is a spring-fed aquifer. And if there is a breach in that pipeline where that aquifer is, there is no way to ever, ever clean that up. And TransCanada, who owns the pipeline that they want to put, has a very bad record of having pipeline breaks, not responding quickly, not doing cleanups, and really contaminating. So, you know, this isn't a native issue. This is a planet issue. And I would really like to encourage people to educate yourselves and stay abreast of what's going on. Deborah Whiteplume, from Bringing Back the Way, is going to different areas, different reservations, and she's doing what they call moccasins on the ground training. And those are weekend workshops where anyone who wants to learn how to to fight these things with civil disobedience. They have civil disobedience training, they have medical training, they have media contact training, and so anyone is welcome. Even though they're hosted on the reservations, everyone is welcome to participate, and that training would be applicable in any situation. So do a Google search for Moccasins on the Ground or Bringing Back the Way, and to stay abreast of those trainings and other information. The water, every living thing on this planet needs water. We have got to protect the water. And we need to start urging everyone to move toward alternative energy sources and put pressure on our elected non-representing representatives Terry, this one's for you. The asshats need to know that we want the free energy models released so that we are not oil dependent. We do not need fossil fuels to run this planet. We need to be able to grow hemp, to produce fuels and building materials, clothing, all of it could be remedied with hemp and or the free energy. So I just encourage all of you to, you know, get involved and don't be complacent and think somebody else is going to do it. We all need to stand up collectively and not only say no, but say hell no. This is our planet. This is what we have to leave for the next seven generations. And I don't think we want our legacy to be that they don't have anywhere to live because they don't have any clean water. Or when they turn the faucet on, you can literally light your water on fire. You know, take responsibility. You know, you are the generation keepers. It is your responsibility. What we leave is our legacy for these children and our grandchildren and their grandchildren. You know, start, you know, put your big girl panties on and your big boy boxers, and let's stand up and just say, enough is enough. This is our planet. It needs to heal. We need to clean this mess up. There are alternatives, and we want to move to that and start taking personal responsibility in your own lives for doing it too, you know? So, yeah, I just wanted to say that, Popeye.
Well said, Gwen. Well said. And, you know, a lot of this destruction that's going on worldwide, and, you know, even in Afghanistan. Why do you think we're in Afghanistan?
Resources.
Yeah, all the lithium.
Resources. Money.
Yeah, it's all about rare earth elements and things like that. It's more than just oil. I mean, the oil, too, but there's more than just that. There's other stuff, too. And that fracking crap, that stuff. Between that and them running pipelines, you know, through aquifers, and it's like, you guys really don't have a reputation for A, being safe with and not having leaks, and B, being timely in your response to them.
Oh, but Popeye is going to create all these jobs that Obama has desecrated. You know, yeah, that's the sell. Oh, it's going to create some jobs.
That's good. They're going to need people to go and put all the diapers down when the oil leaks all over the place. That's just great. You know what I mean? Is that they're creating jobs? Is that what their version of it is?
Well, you know, the thing for me, you know, that I said was, you know, it's a temporary solution to a long-term problem. So we need to look at what the long-term problem is and quit trying to put a Band-Aid on that so that we have a short-term resolution, because nobody's going to live here and nobody's going to have any jobs if the land's contaminated and can't produce food and your cattle are dying from the toxins and you've got no water. So where in the hell are the jobs going to be then, because there's going to be nobody here? Where are we going to go? We don't have another planet to go to at the moment.
Isn't there an old, I shouldn't say Indian, say, even sometimes I repeat it without even thinking about it. Isn't there an old native saying, something like that? You can't eat money, or you can't eat, you know, when mankind is deep, you know, cut all the trees down and, you know, there's going to be nothing left to eat. And you really, what are you going to eat? Your car, your money, your house, you know?
Well, the colonial asshats don't... you know, they don't have anything in their educational curriculum. They don't have anything in the houses of God. They don't have anything in the social media about on a mass level. I mean, you can find pockets here and there, but generally speaking, they don't have a plan for re-education so that we can go back to a way where we're not destroying the planet to live on it. There is a way to do that, but it takes us being personally responsible for our own food sources, for buying locally, saying we're done with these corporate farms, we're done with this, that, that, that. But no, everybody thinks somebody else is going to do it. Oh, I don't want to get involved. Well, one voice doesn't count. You know?
No, one voice does count. It counts more. That's the common thing is, well, I'm powerless. I'm just one person. Well, that's what they've gotten you to believe. The opposite is quite true, though. Gwen, we're out of time. Thank you so much for coming on tonight. Again, taking 2 hours out of your night to hang out with me and the listeners.
It was a pleasure. Thank you for having me, Popeye.
You know, I adore having you on. As I always say, you are one of the few people in the category of my favorite people on this little blue marble. Ladies and gentlemen, we are out of time. Go check out the stuff that we talked about. Check out the books Gwen recommended, the documentaries, and more. Until Tuesday night. I love you all. I'm out.